Okay, hello everyone. Welcome back to I Quit My Band. How's everyone doing tonight?
Good, man.
I'm good. I'm full of spunk tonight, dude.
Me too. I'm a little spunky.
I'm feeling a little, like, pep.
Yeah, we're back to riffing today.
Yeah.
Normal episode.
Yeah.
Let's get rid of this review crap.
Shit. Yeah, get that shit out of here.
Yeah, we've gotten too many views and subscribers.
You guys gotta stop subbing. Yeah, I mean, holy crap. We're in over our heads.
Yeah.
But thanks for subbing. For real.
Yeah.
My name's Nate.
I'm JJ.
I'm Evan.
And we're happy to bring you another new episode of I Quit My Band tonight. Before we get into it, you know, sub to the channel. If you're not subbed, go follow us on our socials, Instagram, TikTok. Leave a comment, like, tell us what you think of the songs. Tell us that we're stupid for not liking them or for liking them.
Tell us if you think Ariel Pink is, like, a cool guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I got, you know.
Someone did that.
Yeah, they were pissed off that we mentioned them, but
yeah,
whatever.
I thought we were pretty neutral.
Yeah,
which is how I feel.
I feel neutral about Ariel Pink.
Yeah.
I like those albums.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I do think it was funny that he was there on January
6th. It was funny.
It's funny. Him and John Mouse being there on January 6th. Two of the last people that I can ever imagine.
Objectively funny.
Just want to imagine what they were doing there.
It's like if Jay Maskus went and hung out there.
Yeah.
You're like, what?
Okay.
With his amps.
Yeah. Wild. Yeah. But, thanks everyone for tuning in to the show. We got another regular episode after doing two reviews. Go check out our review of Idol's new album, Tank, and go check out our review of MGMT's new album, Loss of Life. Two, you know, classic scores from the IQMB. Just off our new rating scale, give them both just strong. Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah. We're right in. We took Pitchfork's place right in the 6.5 zone. Yeah.
Transition.
Yeah.
It's a whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, those were fun. And thanks for subbing if you found us from those two videos. But we're getting back to the normal stuff today. Back to riffing.
As
a lot
God
of
intended.
Great stuff has come out in the past week. I'm excited about it. You know, one of my favorites that I've talked about on the show before, and I'm super pumped. I think we just get into
it. Kick it out.
I can't wait.
He can't hold himself any longer.
Yeah. The Kings are back, dude.
The King has returned.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Kings of Leon.
Yeah, they're back.
They're back. Thank God.
After getting bird shit in their mouth.
Mm-hmm. Being drunk on stage, canceling every show that they've ever played in Pittsburgh. Did I ever tell you that?
Huh?
They played. They had tour dates. Like I was in high school and college maybe, and like 2 years back to back, they had Pittsburgh dates, and then got tickets to both. Fucking week before it canceled.
Boom.
Second year, week before it canceled.
They're pulling a Morrissey.
Dude, I was so pissed. I was like, I'll never like this band ever again.
Have you ever seen them live?
No, I never saw them live.
Man.
Wow.
I know. And I had the chance twice. Yeah.
With
my brother saw them live a long time ago, like right when You Somebody came out.
Oh, my God.
He saw them. But
with this impending release, do you think, have they announced any tour dates yet?
They did announce some tour dates. Nothing in Pittsburgh. But so
road trip.
Road trip to Cincinnati.
Wonder
boys.
If they're playing in Austin.
I looked at that. I did.
That would have been so funny actually, if on your bachelor party we went to go see Kings of Leon.
So funny. That'd
be the most. You're just right
ready
back
for
in
the KOL show, boys.
You're right back in ninth grade up at Pizza Bazaar.
Yeah, save the casino and the bars for someone else.
Honestly,
we're going to see KOL.
You guys would have no idea how much that would mean to me
if
on my bachelor party we was a surprise trip to the KOL show. I'd be so happy. Make my whole life. But anyway, this is their new single, Mustang, that came out this past week. They have a new album on the way called Can We Please Have Fun? Not a great album title, but
no.
This song is okay, I would say. It's not great, but for a KOL fan like me, I feel like maybe everyone who's a KOL fan is probably rejoicing a little bit, because while this isn't like total return to form of their old stuff, it sounds a lot like something that would have been off their second or third record. It has more of a, like, the production's raw, like the guitars sound pretty raw. They're not doing anything crazy with synths or trying to appeal to like arenas, which I feel like they really like made a point to do on their past couple records. I mean, their past couple have been like, there's just been nothing, you know, like nothing good, you know. it's I don't know, like
not was, even like a Ford commercial song.
I don't even
something?
Think a Ford commercial.
Damn,
yeah.
Sucks.
They had one song called "Waste a Moment" from an album that came out in like 2016.
That's what
like,
you do when you listen to that song.
Yeah, they. Yeah, you're they wasting
got
it, a moment.
Got 'em.
Yeah.
Well, did you? Listen to the NFT album because they released the NFT album eventually.
Yeah, no, I did listen to the NFT album. And it was like it was super boring. Like there was really nothing off of that one.
I give them credit. They're like the only people that I know that got in and out of NFTs.
I know.
Made $6 million and like they're good to go. Like I remember Dave Mustaine was on Rogan talking about how NFTs are the future. Like 9 months after anybody gave a shit about them, Dave Mustaine's just like, "Damn, these NFTs are gonna change.
We're gonna do it."
Yeah. What do you mean they're completely worthless?
What do you mean the Kings of Leon did it first?
What do you mean I just bought a JPEG?
What do you mean I'm broke?
Yes.
But listening to the song, I was like, dude, I think I'm a Prince of Leon.
Yes, dude. We're back.
I agree, because it sounds very like it sounds like rock and roll again.
Yeah. I mean the Kings of Leon have always been a band. People probably didn't catch on until about You Somebody. They've always been a band that had just been they make albums that follow the trend of what is big at that moment. Like they want to fit in everywhere. Like their first album was like a Southern rock album.
Is that the one with Tranny and
Yeah.
Dude, that song fucking rules. What's it called? Like Handsome Boy or something?
Youth and Young Manhood.
Yeah.
The Handsome Fella.
I was listening to that this week and I was like, damn, all right.
What's
he's
it called?
Play?
Handsome
I told
Boy?
You, dude. Once you hear it once, you're hooked. You can't stop, you know, you're just, you want to see what's going on in the world.
And you're constantly living in that moment that you played You Somebody and the school kind of knew your name.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, they did their first album, it was like a Southern rock album. Their second album was like, you know, very much in the 2000s alternative rock realm. Their third one like sounded like U2, and then it was You Somebody, and then like you know they try to do the pop thing. The past few albums, this one just sounds like they have nowhere else to go but just be like, all right, let's just write some guitar music. You know, let's write a riff.
Yeah,
one riff.
Hit them with the riff.
They hit us with the riff.
Yeah, dude. Hardy came into the studio and was like, "This is what you got, big boy."
Produced by Hardy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I thought the song was. I thought it was all right. I like it, you know, a good enough. I like it enough to come back to it a couple times. I've listened to it a couple times just off of, like, enjoyment. The lyrics are kind of funny, though. There's one lyric about, like, sitting on the toilet and then, like...
Yeah, I heard that one.
It's like, he says he sits on the toilet and then, like, the next line is, like, I can feel the heat from the water around me. And it's like, just the toilet water?
Why is your toilet hot, bro?
Because of that plumber. Fat dump he took in there. Fucking heated
dumps,
that sucker up.
I just clogged his shit up.
I'm going to write
We're
a song
so
about
back,
it.
Dude. Yeah, dude. We're so back.
Watching that sub count.
Go back to reviewing. Yeah. But yeah, what'd you guys think of it? I mean, well, you said it was good. What'd you think of it?
Yeah, I thought it was good. The lyrics are a little silly, but I like the production. Some neat choices. It's not straight cheese, kind of like I was, you know, expecting when I saw art that just says in big text, "Can we please have fun?"
Yeah.
Give me, like, please clap vibes, like Jeb Bush
Jeb,
type.
Yeah.
It's a little
Low
Jeb
end.
Bush. It's a little bit of a Jeff Bush title. Jeff Bush.
Jeff Bush, yeah.
Yeah, distant cousin of
Jeff
Jeb.
Jeff Bush, yeah.
But, yeah, it's a fine song. It's a whatever.
It's fine.
Yeah.
And that's what all I was really looking for with a new Kings of Leon release.
Yeah.
Just not have it be a huge disappointment.
Yeah, you know? You don't want a turd.
No.
No.
It works.
Well, the turd is in the song.
The turd is in the song.
He was talking about that last album, that NFT album. He's like, I'm just sitting on this dump. $6 million dump I just
burning took. My ass.
Kings of Leon were the first time I ever heard about NFTs. Like, I remember that. Yeah. It was just like, the Kings of Leon are releasing an album on something that's never been done before, an NFT. Like, that was when it broke. You know?
I'm surprised Jack White didn't get into NFTs.
I mean, you know? Yeah. he was seems up his alley.
Yeah, well, he seems more like he would release it on like some 1910s technology that no one's used forever.
He seems
like, I feel like when
anything.
He goes to the doctor, it's like one of those guys with like the big fucking mirror on their head and like has a leather bag that he unzips.
Wore headgear as a child, even though their braces were invented.
All his nurses are just like. Just very young women, and that just, you know,
with the folded thing
the
on their
folded
head.
Thing,
Nurse Ratchet.
Yeah.
Anyways,
let's move on. That's Kings of Leon with Mustang. Their new album's called "Can We Please Have Fun." Let's move on.
Yeah, this is a pick from me. It's coming off an album that I very much liked that came out this past week from a Pittsburgh band called Blinder. It's called EHS off their new album called Drugs of the Sun. Some pretty heavy, noisy-ass shit. And the production is really cool throughout the album. The opening track is just like a straight, like, shoegazy, noisy, post-rocky thing. And this is one that stuck out to me, but I really like the whole album. It was tough to kind of choose one. I haven't liked an album by a local band in quite a while, like this one in quite a while, and it's a good one.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard of Blinder for the past couple years now, and I think this is their first like real release.
It's their debut, full length.
Yeah, I never got to see them live, but they've been playing a lot of shows, and I was excited to check out their music. And the first, like, I didn't listen to the full record yet, but the first half seemed like more like shoegaze vibe, and then when you put this one on, it has like this real heavy punk edge that I liked a lot,
big time.
Yeah, this is my favorite one I've heard so far off of it.
Yeah, I've only heard a handful off the record, but really dig it. I also like that Pittsburgh is kind of becoming like a shoegaze town.
Shoegaze City.
Yeah. You know, like this feels in line with like X-Pilots.
Yeah.
And Gadge. And it's kind of a different type of shoegaze. It's not like your typical low tempo sort of whatever.
This is gnarlier.
Yeah. Like it's noisier, but still just like a ton of whammy bar abuse. Yeah. Dudes just bending the shit out of them.
Yeah. That little bendy tone.
Yeah.
But it is weird that Pittsburgh is doing such a shoegaze thing, like Feeble Little Horse coming out, along these lines, but not as intense as this. I think they have more of like a pop aesthetic to them, but these guitars, like in headphones, are like crazy to listen to. Like they sound insane.
This part
they're
right
so,
here gets me going.
They're so fuzzy.
Produced by Nate Campisi, who is a buddy of mine. He's amazing, but this is sick shit. I really want to see him live.
Yeah, dude. Represent.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh is no longer Steel City. It's Shoegaze City.
Shoegaze City.
Shoe City.
They started shutting down all the shoegaze mills. Guys got nowhere to go.
Yeah. Nah, nobody's got anywhere to get new whammy bars that they busted off of
Johnny Hardhat with his squire. Just... left out
going
to
back
drop.
Down to the mill.
Get a new,
make some gaze.
Get a new Jaguar.
It's not the hot metal bridge anymore. It's the hot shoegaze bridge.
Whoa.
It's fucking hot.
Yeah.
All right. Bad joke.
Got we'll that.
That was EHS by Blinder. Let's move on.
This is a pick from me. This is Pearl Jam with Dark Matter. It's the title track off an upcoming album. Pearl Jam for a long time was my favorite band, like a very long time. They were kind of like my bridge from classic rock to alternative types of rock. Like I remember when I was super into Pearl Jam, I was like, this is the best band that's ever existed.
And then every dad that's ever existed.
And then I heard The Replacements and I was like, oh, okay, it's like the same shit, so kind of.
But cooler.
Exactly. Somewhere around their like self-titled album, they just became like a regular hard rock band.
Yeah, that's what they're put. I mean, what was their last one? It wasn't long ago.
Jamie, look that up.
It was I forget what the hell it's
called. I'll check it
out. It has like a glacier on the front.
Yeah.
And they did release their first single of that was called like Dance of the Clairvoyants, and it had like a Talking Heads thing. I was like, oh, maybe they're doing something new. And then I listened to it. It was like same shit.
Gigaton.
Gigaton. Yeah. But like every time they release a new album, somebody in the band gives an interview where they're like, the new one kind of reminds me of 10. And then guys me who have fallen for it every single time are like,
oh my God.
You're saying there's a chance?
Yeah. Don't do it to me. Come
and
on.
Then, you know, it's like very kind of truck month. Yeah. Just straight down the middle.
It's not bad. I mean, the not riff bad. Is kind of cool. I like the bass tone a lot.
I expected it to be way, way more cheese.
I don't think that they've released anything bad, but I think it's like they're in full sweatpants mode.
Yeah.
They just get in there, play some power chords. They're all good enough musicians where they're going to be able to put it together 10 songs.
Just anytime anyone comes up with any riff in the studio, they're just like,
yep.
hit the record button. Yeah. Play that again?
Yeah.
All right.
I will
base a whole song off of that.
I will say that the production sounds better than some of their other stuff typically does. It's like thicker.
Yeah.
It almost kind of sounds like a Soundgarden song.
The riff is a little bit. Right?
Yeah, and the drums are like thicker. Yeah. Yeah.
Eddie Vedder still got it, dude.
He's still got it. And McCready has a sick solo. I think he's like a pretty underrated guitarist.
Solo at the end.
He can
awesome.
Shred. Yeah. But yeah, it's fun.
Yeah, Eddie Vedder's still doing the, you know.
Yeah,
he's still got it.
He's still got
it. I like that Pearl Jam too. Just with all their like recent album covers, they'll just take any image off of the internet,
slap
their name on it.
Yeah,
they're like, isn't that cool? Isn't that a picture?
Yeah,
it'll
be sick.
That looks like a screenshot from like Oppenheimer. Like when he's like, ugh, and he's like getting visions of the bomb
before Josh Peck launches a nuclear bomb.
Exactly.
It looks like the PS.
After he like rubs like lard on his face or like whatever.
It looks like the PS2 loading screen.
Like, a little bit.
It's like going
floating.
Those rings.
PS2.
Yeah.
I mean, Eddie Vedder sings in a very like sustainable way. Mm. So in like. On paper, he could sound like this for the rest of time. It's not like he's a guy like that is abusing his shit, you know?
No, he's never going to stop.
No.
The early albums had a little more, like, he would scream a little more.
Yeah.
But they've all kind of just leveled
That's
out.
What
that. They go anywhere and play, like, a soccer stadium.
Right.
So, what are, you know.
You don't need to yell.
It's Pearl Jam. Yeah. You don't need to do anything. People are going to listen.
Yeah.
Give us all any idea you have, good or bad.
Play Jeremy, and
everyone
will be happy.
2,500 radio stations that are still playing Better Man twice an hour.
Yeah,
they're fine.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Yeah,
go check out Pearl Jam.
Check out if
go
you
check
haven't
out
heard,
Dark
ever
Matter.
Heard of Pearl Jam.
Yeah,
I would start with Dark Matter.
If you haven't heard of them yet,
start.
Check out.
You should start with their new single if you want to start anywhere.
Yeah,
that'll really get you. You know.
Get
jacked.
You juiced up.
Get you jacked. Yeah.
That's Pearl Jam with Dark Matter. Let's move on. Here's one of my picks. Our boy MGK. I think he's official. I don't know if it's been like this for a while, but he's officially not Machine Gun Kelly.
I was wondering about that.
He's MGK.
Yeah.
This is his new one called Don't Let Me Go. Just basically, you know, a sad piano loop and him reading his diary over top of it.
Yeah.
In like a very dumb delivery and melody that just like doesn't really fit. How much he reveals in this song is a little bit too much.
Way too much.
It's way too much.
Yeah, little like poetry, you know, like allude to certain things.
Yeah.
Like he's calling his family out. Oh my God damn.
He said he was supposed to die as a baby or something like that. And, you know, it's
trauma dumping on
us,
really.
He did. This is a trauma dump.
He took a trauma dump.
For a guy that's massively famous and was dating Megan Fox.
Isn't he still?
Is dating Megan Fox, possibly.
Did you see?
Yeah, this is also the guy that like came at Eminem. You know, like, the guy that was like,
he's
your
got
beard
a...
is weird, dude.
Weird beard.
Weird beard.
I loved Eminem's response to that. It was so good.
What did he say?
It was a track. It was called like Kill Shot.
Yeah. Oh, sick.
He just got his ass pretty hard.
Yeah, I mean, as he should.
Yeah.
Did you see what he did? MGK did though. He like, he like painted his
body. His
whole body. Well, he didn't paint. He like. The trend now in tattooing is like blacking out.
Yeah,
that's crazy looking.
He went full sleep token.
Yeah,
he
did.
Painted his body. Yeah, he's trying to join.
Yeah. He's gonna change his name to Five.
What if MGK was Vessel?
Dude, oh that would God, be so awesome.
That'd
be
the worst thing ever.
I don't know how that community would respond.
How they would react, yeah.
They'd be like, oh, I can't handle the fact that my hero is MGK. Yeah. I can't handle it.
Yeah,
pink guitar guy, I can't handle it.
I mean, they would probably have to support it.
Oh,
For how much...
I have no choice but to side with Megan Fox.
They would have no choice but to be on board, you know. For how much support we've seen from these guys, from the fans.
Oh yeah, yeah, they're committed. I just find the whole MGK project strange. Like,
it's really odd.
To go from rap and then to like two punk pop records and now this.
He got like made fun of so hard as a rapper, transitioned to pop punk, got made fun of so hard as a pop punk artist, and then transitioned back.
He's just
into
like
rap, a
very dislikable figure.
Yeah, and he's like 35 and putting out songs for like 17-year-old girls. Yeah. Like, it's crazy.
He's he's a Logan Paul if he Logan Paul didn't, or the other Paul if they did music.
Grow up, dude.
Yeah, start a podcast.
Start a podcast in your basement, dude. It's time to grow.
Yeah.
Time to take the next step, dude.
Come on.
I didn't like the song.
No, nor did I.
It just
that was a hard skip. Yeah. I think I listened to it twice, and then when it came up in the playlist, I was like, not again.
I was trying to listen to the playlist on my way to work this morning, and then it came up, and I was like, I can't. I can't start the day off like this. Not at all. Yeah, not much to say about it. Just MGK trauma dumping over a sad piano.
Over and over.
It's called Don't Let Me Go if you want to go check it out. Here's another one.
We move from MGK to Mk.gee.
Yeah,
dude.
The stronger of the
MKs and Gs.
Yeah.
This is Dream Police by an artist named Mk.gee off their record Two Star and the Dream Police. Found this a couple weeks ago, and it's one of my favorite albums of the year. It's a really like weird mix of indie rock with like 80s inspired production.
Yes.
And really weird guitar work. Mm-hmm. Like, it's really good guitar work, but you can barely tell because the tone is so strange.
He just turned the rhythm knob all the way up, treble all the way down.
Yeah.
On the amp and the guitar.
Scoop the mids.
There's just, scoop shit.
Yeah, it sounds like pure DI tone. Or like it's coming out of like a keyboard speaker.
Yeah, it's really weird.
The production reminds me a lot of Arthur Russell, which is a guy I've mentioned five times on this podcast. Yeah. It means nothing to you guys.
Yeah, I still haven't checked it out.
Have you ever heard the song 30 Hours by Kanye?
Yeah.
That sample is an Arthur Russell song. So it has this kind of like real murky sort of lo-fi.
Yeah, it's wet.
I know what you mean now.
It's underwater.
Yeah. And what I like about Mk.gee though is whereas a lot of like a lo-fi artist that would be making music like this would have very simple melodies or not really sing at all.
Yeah.
But he has like a great voice.
Yeah.
And really great melodies.
He's like bouncing all over the place.
Kind of reminds me of Billy Ocean at times.
Yeah.
Which I love.
Yeah, it's... I checked it out. I checked out the record after you put this song on the playlist because I was really, like, intrigued by this one. Checked out the whole record, and it is, without a doubt, one of my favorite things I've heard all year. So different. His guitar... It's it feels like a lo-fi bedroom rock or pop record. But it's not really. I mean, he has, like, major chops as a guitarist. He's a good vocalist, too. You can tell he's got some pipes. And, the songs are great. I mean, this one's great. There's one called How Many Miles, which rocks.
That's awesome. Are You Looking Up is
Are You Looking
really
Up is
good.
There's one called I Want, which is really good as well. I mean, the whole record's awesome. And it has this really weird production where it sounds like he's trying to hide... like how talented he is almost with it is like don't listen to how good I am as a vocalist or guitarist, and I kind of love that. It's kind of like he's showing off without showing off in a way. It's really neat to listen to.
Yeah, and it creates like a vibe I've never really heard
specifically
before.
It's like
these sounds
JCPenney of the future.
Yeah.
JCPenney. Yeah, 100%.
Whatever that is.
By that, but,
well, it sounds like you're shopping. It has
Pepsi
like a very...
Blue.
Yeah, it has a little bit of the food court.
It does, but it's not like earnestly old and like pandering in a stupid way, you know, where there's been other... Like, you know, it's not like the king of wishful thinking.
Yeah.
You know?
It's like John Mayer if he came out now. You know what I mean? Like how popular he was then. It's like this generation's version of a guy who's really good at guitar player, really, really good singer. But, you know, we're going to put it in this like quirky millennial production package. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I know what you mean.
Yeah.
Sort of.
Sort of. I'm sure
in
the Mk.gee fans would be like, John Mayer, are you out of your mind? I want to run through the halls of my high school.
Bigger than my body. That's a good song.
There you go.
We're known the world to
But
change.
Go check out Mk.gee because he rocks.
Yeah.
His new album's called Two Star in the Dream Police. It's awesome. Go check it out. I'm going to pay attention to Mk.gee.
Me too.
I'm ready for more Mk.gee. Let's move on.
Yeah, baby.
One of your picks.
One of us had to do this.
Yeah, sure.
And And I was the one that fell on the sword for this one. This is a cut from He Who Must Not Be Named, Kanye West's new record, Vultures. The song is called Carnival. And
put some respect on Ty Dolla
$ign. And Ty Dolla $ign.
It is a collaborative
album. Yeah, a collaborative album between Kanye and Ty Dolla $ign. And I like this song. It's basically Seth Rollins' walkout music from the WWE.
A little bit.
But, you know, if you chant anything, it's going to be cool, kind
of. It reminds me a lot of that song Mo Bamba, which was big.
We got Hollywood. Yeah, it's
Check
same
West.
Vibe. Yeah.
Shout out Sheck West.
Shout out Sheck West.
Anyone remember Sheck West?
No.
I don't.
He dropped Mo Bamba.
Yeah, Mo Bamba.
Done, dude.
That's it.
He was out. Yeah. very
just not going
to. No, I'll talk about it.
You were just like, yeah.
No, I like this song. I liked a couple songs on the record, but I felt like it was more of the same from Kanye.
Yeah.
I thought that this was more consistent than Donda throughout.
Yeah. I thought Donda was really bad, and this was not as really bad.
See, Donda had like real highlights for me, like Keep My Spirit Alive. I love
the one with
Until
the
He Changed
was
It,
good.
And yeah, Jail's really good. What the fuck's the really good one with 504 and God damn it, it's gonna kill me.
I liked God Breathed.
Yeah, that's a good song.
Homage right here.
Yeah. Sounds like a riff from a Fuzz record.
It sounds like it's something off of like Yeezus or something.
Yeah. I don't know. I listened to Vultures and I was number one excited that Kanye was putting out a record that he wasn't like constantly updating while it was out and being like, oh, it's not finished. You know, wait 2 days.
Renting out the Atlanta Stadium for it to not get released 2 weeks in a row.
Like that, I'm happy.
Remember
that
when he was living in the Superdome?
Did you see the picture?
Like finishing the album.
Well, there was like a live stream that you could watch him.
Yeah, it was
in
wild.
A room. Yeah.
Yeah, I was excited that it was just an album that actually came out and you could listen to, and it wasn't 25 tracks. It's really not that long. How many tracks?
I think it's like 15 or 16.
13, yeah.
Yeah.
16. 16. It doesn't feel like that. I actually liked the record. I thought it was pretty good. There's some like classic Kanye moments on it. I liked the song Burn. That feels like an old school Kanye song. I like this one, even though the lyrics on this
stupid.
Are like terrible.
Yeah. That, I think that is... one of the reasons why I don't like it as much is his writing has gotten so bad.
It's just about
well,
sex.
His brain is disintegrating.
Yes,
it's
I mean,
gone.
Like
the
fact that you have enough money to walk into a dentist.
Oh my god!
And you say, take all of my teeth out of my
he
mouth.
He has beautiful
Replace
teeth.
Them with gum wrappers.
Yeah.
And like, I don't know. Can you push down on it? Like, he sounds so weird when he talks now.
I know. Yeah. I feel like he really ruined his ability to like do the thing that he makes money doing.
Probably
we'll
is going
out.
To be difficult.
Yeah.
And it's like, I know way more about his child schooling situation than I wanted to.
Yeah.
Like, I'm always getting updates.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he is like, he's going back, like on this record, he makes like several references to some of the horrible shit he's said and done in the past couple years. Like, as if he's saying like he shouldn't have done it, but not really saying that directly. Like the song Beg Forgiveness,
yeah,
on that, like you can kind of see that he's trying to do that. And there's some lyrics in other songs too. And it's like, you can't just say it and then, yeah, be like, oh, come on.
Plus,
like,
he's done that so many times.
He's done it so many times.
Where he's just going, exactly. You just kind of have to, I don't know, not accept, but like you just know that he's going to continue to do insane shit.
Exactly.
On the music front, I went back and listened to Life of Pablo.
Yeah.
And it's just so much better.
It's been
every way.
It's a great record.
It was his last good, well, it was a complete work, probably his last good work, would you say?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. The album,
Yay,
wasn't bad. I mean, it was only 7 tracks, an EP. It was okay.
Kids See Ghosts was after that, right?
Yeah, Kids See Ghosts was also in that like series of like where he was producing as well. Like, he made his own, but then there was like one
Daytona,
with Nas and one
Nasir,
with...
He was I mean, unbelievable how nuts that... I mean, that's the understatement of the century, but like... He couldn't miss for years.
Yeah, and then just
amazing music.
I honestly think it's kind of a how annoying it is to do the thing where it's like you're gonna say you're releasing an album and then it's like, no, I'm still working on it, and then put out like different versions of it.
I'm a fix wolves.
Yeah, I'm a fix wolves. It's kind of a genius marketing thing because it's like, you release the album, like, you're just constantly releasing the same record.
I think you're giving him too much credit.
I'm not giving him... I don't want to say...
Not credit, but, like, I feel like...
Credit.
Like,
but it's kind of, like... It's an interesting way to release a record,
but
I
think it's the only way...
He's not doing it on purpose.
No, and I think it would only work if you're the most famous artist in the world.
Yeah.
Where people are actually waiting for it.
No one would... If you were doing it as just fucking some guy, then they'd be like... Come on, dumbass.
Yeah, I don't think Mk.gee's going to get away with that on the next one.
What I guess...
I mean...
I'll fix Dream Police.
The funny thing I'm thinking of is like, on paper, it's like he stumbled into something that is an interesting marketing tactic.
Yeah.
But from his end, like his, you know... assistant is behind a laptop. He's like, fucking pull it down. Fuck.
I mean, it's not anything he's doing, like, I don't think so. He's definitely not doing it on purpose.
No.
But it is interesting to drive hype for something that, like, for an extra 2 months that was supposed to be out, like, one
but it's like...
Just interesting.
The greatest artist of our generation is constantly finishing his homework on the bus on the way to school. It is hilarious, but it's not ideal.
It just keeps eyes on him.
Yeah.
I think that's all it is. I think,
like,
it's not really about it being out. It's just about keeping... Like, what happens when records get released? Like,
you listen
to them, and then that's
by Monday,
fucking
in.
Exactly. Like, what I'm saying is, like...
No, I totally get what you're
saying. Like, he's just keeping the hype around him for as long as possible.
Yeah.
Like,
By getting sued.
I mean, there's people fucking write
by
about
accident.
It. You're just constantly in the fucking news, you know?
Yeah.
It's wild that happens that way.
He is a master, because he'll lay low for, like, months where, like, you'll see a little something here and there, and then you know it's an album cycle.
Right.
Because not a week goes by without, like, something
just,
insane
Exactly. It's crazy. It's always, it's just like Kanye season for a while.
Yeah.
That being said, the song's not bad.
No.
I liked...
He's a bad guy. Song's
he's
not
a bad,
bad
dude.
Yeah.
I like Back to Me on this album a lot.
Yeah,
I've listened to that track a lot. Freddie Gibbs verse is just...
The Freddie Gibbs verse is really good.
So hard.
I think, but with the last couple, he's kind of given up looking for a signature sound and kind of just accepted trap as the overall of, like, that's what modern rap sounds like.
He's bringing all these new guys in here, too. It's just like he's appealing to... He's trying to appeal to a younger crowd that... I don't love.
No, I don't
new,
either.
You know, these new dudes. I mean, they're fine. I don't know any a single Ty Dolla Sign song.
No.
Like,
no.
Does he have one that's big?
I'm sure he does.
I'm sure he does.
There's our credibility.
Let me see.
Here, let's check it out.
Okay, his top song is Carnival right now. So, can't even really find out.
Nice.
Okay, let's move on. That's Kanye West with Carnival.
Sick.
Here's one I put on. Called Brown Paper Bag by Dive. Dive is... They were kind of a shoe... Like, one of these newer shoegaze bands that kind of broke onto the scene, like, I feel like a while ago now. It was probably, like, I think, like, 2009 or something was their first record. And they haven't put out many. I think only, like, maybe two or three records. This might be their third coming out. So it was cool to see them come back a little bit with this single. Their last album was pretty good, too. I can't remember what it was called. I think... Shit. Deceiver.
Hell yeah.
Sorry. We don't have a Jamie here. Yeah, it was called Deceiver. It was a pretty good record. I thought this song was good, but I wanted to see what you guys thought of it, because it's like, there's so many bands now, like we just saw with like Blinder when we were talking about like doing this shoegaze thing. I feel like Dive probably was an originator of like doing this and making it popular, but probably being surpassed pretty heavily now. Like I thought I'd rather listen to like Feeble Little Horse or like Hotline TNT over this song. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, there's a fine line to me for what makes this genre interesting. And it's because sometimes it's just slow, meandering, drony stuff, like with an emo tinge.
Yeah.
Which kind of is how I feel about this particular song. It's not like I've heard much worse in terms of shoegaze and things like that. I still think it's a decent song, but I think it's like... There's an X factor there that, like, some of these younger bands kind of, like, apply to the genre that makes it more appealing to me, whether that's, like, production choices, intensity, noise, fuzz, whatever. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I mean, like, they brought the, you know, shoegaze back a little bit and then, like, kind of disappeared for a while. Now it's bigger, and I feel like there's much better music being made than something like this.
Yeah, it feels very like classically shoegaze.
Yeah,
like it sounds like something Slow Dive would have made.
Yeah,
it sounds the it seems like they take a little more from Pumpkins, like a little heavier guitars.
Yeah, I could see that.
I did like the rollout when I saw the SNL thing, and I was like,
yeah, that was good.
I'm an idiot, and I was like, oh, that's probably real.
I thought the same thing. I was like, what?
SNL
Fred Durst and Dive?
He's going to host?
I was like,
gonna be
that? Well, it was like Shane Gillis, and you're like, anything's possible.
Yeah, yeah, they could get Durst in there.
Durst and Dive.
But did you see the music video?
No.
So they released a music video where they are on like an SNL-type stage, and they're introduced by Fred Durst. He's like, ladies and gentlemen.
That's really cool.
Oh, that's awesome.
So I was like, that's pretty sick.
Yeah,
they made a whole thing about it.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah, that's sick.
But yeah, I didn't hate the song. It did kind of just feel like classic shoegaze, where I would agree that there are bands now that I feel like are bringing more to the genre.
Yeah.
That this kind of feels like quaint in comparison.
Yeah, I'm glad that they're back. I'm excited to see what their next record's going to be. And maybe if they can apply some, you know, newer ideas to the genre. But, yeah, I wasn't too impressed with this song. I just wanted to shout it out because they haven't released new music in a really long time now. Or 5 years, so.
That's a decent amount of time.
Welcome back, Dive.
Welcome back.
Yeah.
Dive into Dive.
Dive into Dive. Sorry, next song. Started pretty fast.
This is one from me. This is Crimson to Chrome by Friko. Off their album Where We've Been, Where We Go From Here. If Mk.gee is one of my favorite albums of the year, this is my favorite album of the year.
Wow.
Found this around the same time, and it's just, I love it. It's very inspired by like early 2000s indie rock. The singer gives me like Bright Eyes vibes with that like wavery vocal.
Yeah.
But the music has sort of like a similar to like Wolf Parade or those bands around that time period where they were making like big epic songs, but just with rock instrumentation, which I like a lot. And I love this song. It's really catchy. And I like that. I feel like indie rock has kind of become like very like buttoned down over the past couple years. And it's like very like moody or contemplative. And like to hear a fucking band. Like,
yeah.
Lean on the rock of indie rock.
Yeah.
I was like, hell yeah.
That's what I thought about it, too. Like, I never heard of them before, but I was
Neither
like, I was, it was cool to hear a rock band that's not like hiding behind anything. Like, it's just a good song with good performances.
Good singer.
A great singer. Reminded me a lot of Screaming Females.
Yeah, sure.
There was another band that you really liked. I can't remember. Oh, Hop Along.
Oh, yeah.
Sort of like Hop Along, where it's just fucking straight up rock, you know? Yeah. And it's just good songwriting.
I really like this song. There's a cool moment where, like, the instruments cut.
Right here.
Right there.
This is so sick.
It really caught. That particular moment caught me. And then there's, like, some more shit that happens in the end part. It's just a cool melody. It's like how the vocal line is ascending. It is very. It captured my attention. I really like this song.
Are they just a duo?
They are. Yeah.
Oh,
I mean,
cool.
There's more people in the band, but I think they're like the creative core.
The MGMT.
Yeah, this is their debut. They're from Chicago.
They're very cool.
Yeah, I like the, a lot of indie, like you said, hiding behind something. I think is a good. Because there's so much like production and stuff that goes into songs now.
Yeah.
Where a lot of times you hear something that's like a very boring song that they've just put like 70 stems of production over top of.
As much reverb as possible.
Verb it out.
But this is like a reminder that with like creativity and like
talent.
Sharp songwriting and arrangements, you can make something that feels modern and immediate with just the instrumentation of rock and roll.
Yeah, for sure. It's kind of like the opposite of what we were talking about with Mk.gee. Even though, like, Mk.gee has still really loved it, like, you can overdo it in a way, but, like, this is kind of, you know, showing your strengths as directly as you possibly can.
And, you know, both artists are really talented, and it shows in different ways.
Yeah,
and, like,
exactly.
It's not like this is negated because the talent is very upfront and noticeable, whereas Mk.gee... It's, like, very buried, but it's both artistic choices are neat and enjoyable in their own way.
Absolutely. I thought Friko was going to be a rapper. I was like, Friko sounds like a fucking sick rap, dude.
Yeah, dude, he's about to put bars
Friko.
On
Friko, yeah.
And then it just sounds like Connor Oberst.
Yeah, I was really expecting a rap song, like a crude rap song.
Well, you're about to get one.
We're about to get one.
What's up, boys?
JJ is back.
This song is called Fashion Icon by Aliyah's Interlude. This song's about me. And
I was thinking time
I even realized
every
that.
Time this came on, I just imagine you trying on a new pair of $250 boots.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. This song, I heard it, and I'm like, I feel good, I look good.
Just dancing in front of a mirror at like a Target.
At a DSW. Just like, fashion, I come.
Yeah, yeah.
So he's like, can I help you? Yeah. Are you going to buy those? Or are you going to fucking dance?
No, no, I'm not going to try them on.
Yeah, I don't know.
Buffalo Bill.
I just turned into a sleep token / Buffalo Bill. It's just a, you know, a stupid little slutty song from your boy. There's not much to it. It's like 2 minutes long.
Yeah.
But I'm a fashion icon, and so is this chick. So there we go.
Yeah, this song made me realize how many songs exactly like this there have been in the past.
Yeah.
I was like, damn, we're talking about fucking being a spoiled brat again.
Yeah. Oh, it's a never-ending pool.
Yeah, we're talking about like brands and songs.
Yeah, I'm a
again.
Little bitch.
It's like, how many Nicki Minaj's can there be?
A million.
You know what I mean? Damn.
Yeah, and the specific energy of this one really made me feel like I was having an aneurysm.
Yeah.
Where, like, every time it came on, I was just... Between this and the MGK, I was like, no, no. thank you.
There's, like, a glitchiness to this one, too. Like, and that really is...
And she comes in letting you know right away.
Fucking,
listen, bitch.
Yeah.
I got clothes.
What does she say she is? She's a fucking...
Fashion icon.
No, but there's like another
thing.
She
kicks the door down, really.
It's literally so exhausting being the most cunt bitch in the world.
Yeah, that's cool. I mean, I feel her on that.
All right.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a marketing executive, and I'm exhausted. I could imagine being the
most cunt
bitch on earth.
Bitch in the world. Yeah,
dude.
Damn.
I didn't know she said cunt. I thought she said cut.
Yeah, I thought it was cut, too. And then I remember looking it up today, and it's
damn,
it is
exhausting.
Cunt bitch.
I like that you listen to it and you're like, I need to dig deeper, see what's
let's
going
go back
on.
To the lyrics
let's open
is
up
it
the hood.
Cunt?
Yeah. And I heard some brand names. I didn't hear Route 66 or Arizona jeans, which is what I wear.
I didn't hear, buddies, the Target brand t-shirts that just fall apart after three wears.
I didn't hear any Longfellow Wrangler
that's
jeans.
What it is. I said
Goodfellow and Co.
Goodfellow.
Goodfellow and Co. Goodfellow
that just fucking you just put it on, your stomach is just hanging out.
One wash cycle and that thing looks fucked up.
Yeah, I didn't hear any Amazon Essentials in that song either.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good stuff from from whoever that is.
From the most cunt bitch on the world.
In the world.
On the world.
She's
on
she's on it. She's exhausted.
Aliyah's Interlude with Fashion Icon.
Mm-hmm.
Let's move on.
Yep.
This is my last pick. This is Jesse Murph with Son of a Bitch. And this is what this podcast does is I had three songs that I liked, and then I was like, I got to find like a dumb one that we can talk about.
Yeah.
And then I found this one, and I put it on, and now I like it. So
how it goes.
I like it more than the other one. So.
I like this better than my former favorite band, Pearl Jam. What drew me to it is I like what's going on in country where there's like, it's rural, but they're bringing in like this urban sort of swag.
Yeah.
She looks like it's like she would be wearing a cowboy hat, but she talks like Little Kim.
Yeah.
And that's just confusing in my mind.
It's kind of like the updated version of Before He Cheats, almost, you know? Like, what would that sound like in 2024?
Like a Lana Del Rey song.
Like just a bitch girl, just who fucking hates you. You know what I mean?
Yeah, he's about to take a 9 iron to your fucking Chevrolet.
Just doing everything Carrie Underwood says she'll do in the song, but like, probably with some like real
hatred
charges.
Yeah, exactly. We got receipts.
With some investigation going on. It's not just like, she scraped your car. It's like she's calling your mom on a, 24/7 basis, every minute, harassing her. You know,
she's sending your.
We gotta look into it.
She's sending your internet history to your dad.
Exactly. She's sending nudes to your dad.
Along with your browser history.
But I thought it was funny. I thought it was, the instrumental again sounds like an HBO series. I kind of like that. She's got quite a swagger to her. Jess Murph.
And
Jess
I wasn't Murph. Aware of her, but she has like 10 million. I guess she she had a song with Jelly Roll.
Oh, that'll
people love
do it.
That guy, right?
They do. People love that guy.
I've not heard one thing that he's done, but I've seen him a lot.
I've seen him,
He gave a really, in all seriousness, a really cool, impassioned speech to like Congress or something
about Zin pouches?
Fat rappers are always doing that. They're always talking to Congress.
No, he spoke against like fucking like overdoses and fentanyl.
That's
shit,
what I'm saying.
Like,
they're always talking. They're always the person on the front line.
He is
we
very,
need more of them.
Very smart and articulate, and he looks like that, which is beautiful. That's 2024 for you.
We need more fat rappers who will stand up for us.
For Congress.
Yeah.
Action Bronson.
Action Bronson.
Jelly Roll.
Killer Mike.
Killer Mike.
We need to drain the swamp and then fill that big drain hole with jig dudes.
Fat dudes who are smart and good at rapping who will have the nuts to talk in front
we
of Congress.
We could probably ditch, however many chairs are in there, ditch a quarter
drain
of
the
them.
Swamp, plug the hole.
It's the secret sauce.
That's
that they're eating and then going in front of Congress and talking.
That's how we fix this fractured nation.
Yeah, dude.
Big boys.
That's the turd that fucking Kings of Leon are talking about that clogged up the toilet.
I want to see the SAT scores of any fat kid who can rap.
If you clear 1,200,
you're brilliant.
You're going on to Washington. Well, you're going to be on the Lincoln Memorial.
You're our only hope. You're really our only
talking
hope.
Talking about, like, agriculture. Like, it's not even about, like, the streets anymore.
The cabinet.
Yeah.
The snack cabinet.
Dude.
Yeah. I can't stop. I can't stop. It just keeps going, dude. Oh, man. I'm sorry. I'm not, I like
Jelly Roll's a cool guy.
I like Killer Mike. I like Action Bronson.
I would hang out with any of them.
Yeah.
I would love to go into an In-N-Out with those guys.
Yeah, me too.
Throw down.
Yeah. Wanna have... And they stiff you with the bill. Bankrupt
right,
you.
Right. I'm done. Yeah.
You're taking care of that, right?
Yeah.
Let's move on. That son of a bitch from Jesse Murph.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Let's do this one first and then end on yours.
Okay. All right.
This is one that I put on here. It's a new Vampire Weekend called Capricorn. I didn't know Vampire Weekend was back. I didn't know they were releasing stuff again.
They
so.
Seem to have a mystique about them.
Yeah, they kind of gained that after their one record.
Yeah.
That Vampires of the City record.
Which is the second one?
I think it's the third.
Okay.
Yeah.
So good.
It's Contra. And
Contra's
then...
the second, and then Vampires, Modern Vampires of the City.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
then, like, they disappeared for a little bit. And that record was, like, so good and different for them that I think that they became more of, like, a legendary type of band
yeah.
That is like a you know a unicorn few and far between. I like their last record. This it was very clean, very 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 Vampire Weekend. This was like exactly the opposite. I felt like this production is
I
so
love this little piano.
Yeah, this production is so messy and so lo-fi and sounds like just very low budget. But I liked it a lot. I thought the guitars were really cool at the end, like. They're really fuzzy, and they don't even really sound like guitars almost. It just sounds like noise, and he's got such a weird, like, gate and reverb on his vocal. The
yeah.
drums as well, they sound really dry, but, you know, kind of has that Antonoff flair about it, where it's like,
uh-oh.
Things are sounding like they shouldn't, but I don't know, I enjoyed it in this case. I thought the melody was good. Maybe it would be better with cleaner production, but I don't know. I like the direction they're going in. What did you guys think?
Yeah, I liked it. I have a thing with Vampire Weekend where just the like preppiness of them, especially when they
me.
First, yeah,
yeah,
it like activates every white trash molecule
yeah.
in my body.
You just want
to
fucking.
You think you're better
ass.
Than me?
Yeah, dude.
And then it sucks that they write such good songs.
They write good songs.
Yeah,
I'm
like,
yeah.
exactly.
I was a Vampire Weekend. Like I was just trying to avoid them, like the plague. I was like, I can't listen to that in high school. People liked it. I'm like, just take one look. You know?
Yeah. I watch professional wrestling. I cannot listen to Vampire Weekend.
The
yeah.
salmon shorts
yeah.
and like the you know, the polos just
And then you
yeah.
hear A-Punk and you're
and
like
fuck.
It's too
so good.
Shit.
Yeah, it's actually good.
Yeah, and I wasn't a big fan of the last one. That was the one that kinda sounded like Graceland a little bit.
Mm.
The one that like came out pretty recently.
Yeah, it has
Father
like,
of the Bride.
Yeah, it has like the globe on the
yeah.
front.
I actually like
Gen
that
X
one
Cops.
A lot, and I didn't.
It's another song.
I did not expect to. Like,
yeah,
I'm not a huge Vampire Weekend fan at all, but the songs I heard from that I loved. I thought it was. The record's pretty long, so I don't really remember a ton of it. But there's a couple great ones off of that. Yeah, I'm excited to see where they're going next. Shout out Vampire Weekend. Is that it? Do you have anything to say?
That's it. That's it.
Okay. Yeah.
That's a pretty good song.
Yeah, yeah. Good. It's good. All right, moving on to the last song.
In a very different vibe, mm-hmm. we're closing it out with a song called Lost in the Dark by, I guess it's a collab between Left to Suffer and Paleface Swiss.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just the gnarliest fucking shit ever. Like, ass-beating shit. Like, this
Hell
is a
yeah,
song
dude.
You want to kill people to. I'm not a crowd kill guy, but I like there's a breakdown where I just want to swing.
You
want to
do that dance?
Yeah, yeah. That, yeah, yeah, you got it.
The skanking, or
yeah.
whatever the fuck it's called.
It's not skanking quite, but like they're
yeah.
just trying to like brutalize people
Violent
around them.
Skanking.
Yeah,
this makes me want to go like with those German dudes under the bridge. You
oh
know?
Yeah. yeah,
yeah,
yeah. The cyber goths.
Yeah.
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, this song starts insane. And then just keeps getting
it
more
gets
and
crazy.
More
it has the
well, there's a
yeah. yeah. Can we go back to that real
yeah.
quick?
Yeah. Real quick. Yeah,
we switch.
This has us written all over it. This should be about the end of the world.
Yeah, it should be about the end
it
of the
should,
world,
but
it's,
not,
about,
it's
about not having a flashlight.
Yeah,
yeah.
I'm lost
I was
in
hoping,
the dark, dude.
I was hoping for this song to be for about the end of the world or we're fucked
did you guys
or anything.
Did you read the lyrics?
No.
They're like it's. Like, these lyrics are, like, Coldplay level.
Yeah.
Like,
are you serious? Like,
it's so funny.
It's a beautiful
the
day.
Contradiction between
yeah.
how this sounds and what the lyrics are. Like, Maybe lost in the dark for all these years, I've been standing on my own two feet without you. I still think of you when I'm not supposed to. Start with a spark and it fades into the Milky Way.
Yeah.
Tear my heart out, leaving me gutted while I'm watching. Like, that's like, that's Chris Martin.
Yeah.
Yeah. Until it gets to the end and it's like,
bitch, fuck you.
Yeah. Oh, fuck. Come on, bro. Take over again. Yeah, there's one. There's one.
Turn
like,
that
horrific.
Shit up a little bit.
Here we go.
It gets really gnarly.
Yeah, it just keeps getting more insane. I remember seeing an art project online about this guy that was doing self-portraits while he had schizophrenia.
Yeah.
And it was like you keep watching them.
Oh,
get
I've
more.
Seen that.
Yeah, I've seen
yeah.
that.
This, it felt like that, but a guy like making a WWE walkout song as he started going more and more insane.
In like the span of 4 minutes.
Yeah.
The crowd just, as the louder they cheer, the more he's like, we need another corn dog bark.
Yeah,
it's awesome. Yeah, it seems like one of these bands, whoever like probably left to suffer, like they seem like, you know, dude, the pig growl.
So it's crazy, yeah. Dude. I'm just making this like,
yeah,
this face the whole time. Yeah. Yeah,
like left to suffer. They seem like fairly, you know, normal looking guys, and then they've, you know, outsourced Paleface Swiss, who are. But judging by this photo, they're particularly scary.
They're
guys
scary, yeah.
That
bloody.
Probably added the scary noises. I'm guessing,
they're in like the Saw basement.
Yeah, they're
in their band.
They're all bloody. And
I
want
to play a game.
Yeah, in the Saw basement.
Let's play. Let's make a gnarly song.
Yeah.
Do you have a fuzz pedal? Yeah. You need to.
Yeah.
You need to imitate Jonathan Davis.
Yeah.
Live or die.
Did you buy a Metal Zone pedal?
How much falling in reverse have you heard?
Tune your guitar to drop G.
How much do you love Ronnie Radke?
Liver.
Would you bet your life on it?
That's pretty good,
Nate. I'm just riffing, dude.
would you bet your life on it?
Would you bet your life on Ronnie Radke?
I don't know what I'm saying.
I actually preferred the earlier work. You're like listening to the fuck. I'm like, what the fuck is
you prefer the earlier work? Have you heard Watch the World Burn?
Yeah, I've heard it.
It's IQMB Song of the Year.
It's cool, but I mean, he lost a lot of his edge.
I prefer the emo core elements, if I have to be honest. I
just missed that time.
I don't respect what he did
but
with
his mic
stand.
But yeah, you're going to have
stands.
To saw your leg off.
Anyways,
I have a mic stand that you're going to need to shove down your throat.
But yeah, the key's in your brain, and there's a saw next to you, so figure that out.
I have a dozen mice. They're going to eat your eyeballs out and then find the key.
The key is in your brain. Yeah.
So good. Woo! Oh, we're so bad.
We're back.
Oh, man.
As if we didn't go anywhere.
That's
it.
Thanks everyone for watching. I quit my band.
Ugh.
This has been a fun episode. Mm-hmm. if you haven't subbed, go ahead and subscribe. Like, comment, follow us on Instagram, follow us on TikTok, and sub to our Patreon page. You can find that all in the description below. And we'll see you next time. Thank you.